lots of seats up here, so feel free. In terms of my book, from Wall Street to Bay Street, a comparison of the two financial systems, you will see that it was written by Christopher Kolbrak and Joe Martin. Chris Kolbrak was an extraordinary individual who I first met in Milan in 2010 at the Bocconi University. And we were looking desperately, Hal had contributed financially, substantially, to finding a chair of Canadian business history. And we finally ended up selecting an American from Brooklyn who has at least 3 degrees from Columbia, who taught at the École de Commerce Supérieur de Paris for 25 years. But in his brief time in Canada, and it was brief because in January of 2017, his body was found dead in his apartment in Paris. It was, he had a bad heart, and he was supposed to be at my birthday party a week later, and we were going to finish the book. He was clearly an inspiration for the notion of the Canadian business Canadian Business Historical Association, and the book was his idea. And so those of us who got to know him, and he was an extraordinary individual, if you even gave a hint that you were going to go to Paris, you would be asked to stay at his apartment, and it was a very nice apartment in the 11e arrondissement, and I stayed there many times, and we all miss him very much. So he was a big part of this book, inspiration, and we were going to finish in January of 2017, we're going to finish it together. That didn't happen, but I must say that I reached out to many of his friends throughout the United States of America, and indeed in Europe, for the second round of reviews, which are required in academia, and they all responded promptly. Now, sidebar to our book, which is an analysis of why, you know, you've seen a lot this past week of the demise of the Lehman Brothers. You've seen a lot in the media in the past week of what went wrong. What I've been a wee bit surprised with, there hasn't been much describing what went right in Canada. A lot went right in Canada. Canada was a model for the world. And so if you read this book, because Chris believed that he was a business historian, but business doesn't come out of nowhere, it comes from being part of a greater social fabric. And that's what this book traces, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about that. But first, independent, the Faradays, came up with the notion of doing a documentary, sidebar. And we're going to give you a teaser for 2 minutes, and then I'll tell you a little bit about the book. This is the son, in case you haven't figured it out.
Yes. I'm not the brother, I'm the father.
This is one of Canada's great jewels. I mean, we would not have the country we have if our banks had been less than they are.
Canada has a Hamiltonian banking system with large banks that have a national presence, lots of branches.
The branch banking system enabled the banks to expand across the country. They followed the railway.
American West was opened by a sheriff getting off the train with a six-gun.
Canadian West consultant, by a banker getting off the CPR with a safe start branch.
You've got these two countries that are so similar in many regards, but our banking systems are totally different.
Canadian banks do have an attitude where they will help each other.
The fact that we have one incredibly strong regulator in the case of Boston, I think has stood us in very good stead.
You know, that was a huge coup for the system. I don't think to this day people know how significant it was.
In other countries, you have very rule-based organizations. Essentially, lawyers are allowed to run the process. We don't have that in Canada. The regulatory framework in which they operate is one that doesn't too much restrain their better instincts and does protect them when they have a bad brain, which everybody does sometimes.
The Canadian banking system seems to be more stable, but maybe it's been less innovative than the United States has been.
I mean, we have what comes to basically an oligopolistic system, which makes them relatively conservative.
They're really too big and too powerful. I mean, they really control all aspects of our financial services industry.
So I think the major change within banks has really been the rise of women.
I think he would have to say that women have actually really broken through.
When you had a balance between women and men in a group, you got a better result than if you had only men. This is a competitive advantage.
Canada did not suffer nearly as much from the financial crisis in 2008 because its banks were much more soundly governed.
Our view was always that you should be able to make a little bit of money even in severe downturn. But in good time, you should be able to make a lot of money.
We built in this more conservative culture, to use a word I wouldn't normally use.
So that's the teaser. I suspect you recognize the number of the people interviewed, and Kevin and I had lunch yesterday, and we're hoping to get something by mid-October at the latest, and that we're talking to a number of networks about showing that on television, and we're planning to submit the hot dogs.
Yep. We'll see. Maybe TV Ontario, maybe WND, maybe a few documentary film festivals.
So let me just, we've got a bar, we've got food, and so I won't keep you long. So let me give you a brief, a 90,000-foot version of why Canada was different in 2008 in the United States. It drove me crazy at the time of 2008, the number of people who said, was because the government of the day stopped the big bank mergers. Now, I think it was a good decision, don't get me wrong, but it was not fundamental. But I'm going to close with that. I'm going to talk about what I consider the four or five key considerations. The first is, I think I've got some exhibits here. Canada, ironically, has a Hamiltonian system, U.S. $10 bill. Alexander Hamilton was a genius. He was the brightest of that group, incredible group of people who surrounded George Washington. And even though Jefferson opposed him, he was successful in convincing Washington that they could have a central bank. And if you look at the charter of the Bank of Montreal, the first bank in Canada in 1817 was almost identical to the first bank of the United States. And I'll talk a little bit more about that when I get to 1864, which will be shortly. The United States does not have a Hamiltonian system. They have a Jacksonian system. And Andrew Jackson, among a lot of bad things he did, and he probably did more than any other president until the current one, current presidents moved his picture in the Oval Office, I might add, killed the bank as well as killing a lot of Aboriginal people. tiers. So as we came to have a country, the leaders from the different areas, four factors governing them, the threat from the United States, a powerful army, the indifference of the Gladstone liberals in London, the bad politics in Canada, and new technology, which would permit maritime provinces to connect with the Canadian province, because wind was being replaced by steam. And so they gathered in 1864, first in Charlottetown and then in Quebec City, and later in London. And the prime person in writing that constitution was Sir Johnny Macdonald, and with him was a copy of the 1784 secret proceedings of the Philadelphia Convention. When America, remember that from 1766 to 1787, America had a disaster system. There were many presidents prior to George Washington. Macdonald had a copy of that. It was pencil marked. It was not annotated. I have a digital version of it, which I acquired from Boston, where a lot of Hamilton's documents are, or Macdonald's documents are. And out of that, he crafted a constitution, the British North America Act, with two fundamental provisions in Section 92. One, the federal authority would be responsible for banking. And two, the federal authority would be responsible for currency. Go online, check the American Constitution. Those are not in the American Constitution. And that has caused a lot of trouble. And I have seen some recent evidence from the more outlying investment people who are saying the currency issue is going to be the biggest problem in the United States, because I've seen at least one eccentric but forward-looking investment advisor who's saying there are 10 states now preparing to issue their own currency, violate the legislation under Lincoln in 1864, but remember, it's not constitutional. It's a piece of legislation. And so there was a challenging time. So Macdonald got those two key provisions in. Hamilton and Macdonald, the Constitutional Congress. And then we finally got together. And we got a Bank Act. But it took us 2 years of struggle and strife. And the first Minister of Finance was Alexander Galt, father of Confederation, the man who first proposed the notion of Confederation in a legislative assembly. But unfortunately, he was also a shareholder in the Central Bank of the Midland District in Kingston. And that bank went down. So while Macdonald was creating this country, it was not in a static environment. All hell was breaking loose. Americans were canceling free trade. The two biggest banks in Ontario went down, first Upper Canada and then the Midland District. And Galt was a big investor, and he requested a bailout. And the cabinet said no. I suspect, I don't know this, Macdonald would have probably preferred to say yes, because the bank was based in Kingston, and he had a lot in that as well. But the cabinet said no. There was no bailout. So 3 months after our country was created, we got our second Minister of Finance, Sir John Rose. And Sir John Rose was, like so many immigrants of the day, a brilliant man. He had an extraordinary career. He was on the boards of directors of all the major corporations, including the Bank of Montreal and the Hudson Bay Company. And then, and he was Johnny's best friend in the House. And he presented a proposal for the Bank Act in 1869, which was a copy of the American, the National Bank Act of 1864, which was supported strongly by the Bank of Montreal, the major bank at the time, and the wild men of the West. And then the West was southwestern Ontario, rose up and said to John A., we will not accept that. We support your party. We will not accept that Bank Act, which would make the Bank of Montreal like the Bank of England, and the rest of them would be county banks. so Rose read the handwriting on the wall, and he, like the CEO of the Bank of Montreal, left Canada for Europe. So, running along now, it's late 1869, we don't have a Minister of Finance. So then MacDonald went to one of the unsung heroes of Canadian Confederation, Sir Francis Hincks, who before Confederation had been Minister of Finance and then First Minister in the province of Canada, who'd been governor of a number of British colonies. And this shows MacDonald's managerial ability. He didn't summon him to Ottawa. He got on the train and went to Montreal and met with him and convinced him he should become Minister of Finance. Now, I've looked at a lot of Canadian history textbooks. They generally say MacDonald did that to shore up a liberal conservative coalition because Hincks was a liberal. Well, if he did it for that purpose, he failed miserably because both the Tories and the Liberals were angry with him. But Hincks knew finance. He knew he may not have been an Alexander Hamilton, but he knew finance. And so he presented a bill, the key compromise being, and compromises are necessary in politics, that rather than have Rose's proposal that the government should issue all the paper currency, they would draw a line of $4, the banks would issue those over $4, and the government under. And that was becoming the crucial liability for the banks, because deposits weren't that common in those days. So they got a place to have their liabilities which would generate assets. But the key thing in terms of that legislation was a provision which I have never seen anywhere else. My colleague, late colleague, Chris Kobrak, who knows a lot more about banking than I do, said we shall have, by law, every decade, parliamentary review of the Bank Act, so that the people, through Parliament and the banks, Bankers Association, would review what the Bank Act should be. And by 1900, the government went to the banks and said, we don't have to have it anymore. And the banks said, no, no, it's useful. And so that's what we've had ever since. Gradualism, now it's every 5 years. So contrast that with what happened in the United States, where you had Dodd-Frank replacing the Glass-Steagall legislation, which is about 60 years difference. And I don't know if there are many systems more complex than financial systems. So then we fast forward to the 80s. I know most of you are too young to remember those old days. But our banks did not do well in the 80s. There was a lot of bad banking done, and with deference to my good friend Hal, a lot of bad trust company business done. And a lot of trust companies and at least five banks went down. So the government stepped forward, appointed a commission that looked into it, and they came up with the idea of something called the Office of the Superintendent of Financial Institutions. So in 2008, we had for 20 years the Office of the Superintendent of Financial Institutions, and is, as the liberal Martin said, as distinct from this conservative Martin, both of us agree that it was the right thing. Office of the Superintendent of Financial Institutions was an outstanding decision, and we proceeded from there, that office. In concluding, I'd like to give you a light moment from the late 1990s. In my case book, the previous book, not the one that's back there, I had a case on RBC early 21st century, and we deal with the attempted mergers of the two banks, of the big banks. And if you're using the case method of teaching, I find it takes four or five times to get it right. And I not only evaluate the students after I've taught, but I evaluate myself. I wrote that. I think I finally got it right. The next morning, a student who I knew personally came up and said, Joe, with respect, I think you blew it yesterday. Why? He told me, by the way, a person who worked on history with me at the Albany Club. And as soon as he said it, I said, he was right. He said, you got a great description in there about what happened in the late 90s, but you didn't deal with it. So by sheer coincidence, I was going downtown that day for a meeting with Charlie Bailey, who you saw on the picture from TD. And we did our business, and then I said to him, Charlie, I don't want to pick scabs off of old wounds, but would you mind telling me about what it was like in the late 90s? And he got that funny grin on his face. You know, Charlie Bailey was a very successful CEO of a big bank, but he looked more like an Irish leprechaun than he did a bank CEO. And he said, did I tell you about Kretka? Well, that's the last response I expected. I said, no, you didn't tell me about Kretka. What about Kretka? Well, he said, as soon as we got the rumor of the merger of RBC and BMO, we phoned Jim Peterson, who was then the parliamentary assistant to the Ministry of Finance, and we said, we're not trying to get, do anything wrong. We just need to know this for competitive purposes. And so a few days later, the Prime Minister, Mr. Cretton, phoned Dick Thompson, who had been CEO, but was now chairman, and said, Dick, it's not going to happen. For those of you who knew that he was from the University of Manitoba originally, went on to great success. He was a very straightforward guy. And so he said, should I call Paul? And Mr. Cretton said, Paul who? So thank you very much for attending this event. We can have a question or two now, or we can have them over drinks, whatever the audience preference is. My sense is you prefer to drink.